He was elevated as Vice Chairman NDMA in December 2010. He hails from a well-known political family and is a fourth time sitting member of the Andhra Pradesh Legislative Assembly. May I request him to kindly make the opening remarks.
My distinguished colleague members of the NDMA, officers from NDMA, distinguished panelists, ladies and gentlemen. We are running half an hour late. The next session is a very brief, we'll have a very brief valedictory address by the Honorable Chief Minister of Uttarakhand. We have requested him to come 15 minutes late, so that effectively gives us about 45 minutes. I think we started off with lessons learned from Uttarakhand, and I think what is going to be looked at in this session is also a part of the lessons learned, and then what we need to be doing to put in place a better observational and forecasting capability. Looking back to 2004, the Indian Ocean tsunami, which devastated the Indian Ocean region, leaving about 16,000 people dead in India, about 2,30,000 people dead in the Indian Ocean region. Dr. Sailesh Nayak was then the director of INCOIS. The government of India decided to take this challenge. We lost so many lives because we didn't have a system that could give us some warning. The government of India decided to bridge this gap. And today, in fact, the last it is about 5 years that the center has been functioning. We have a state-of-the-art tsunami warning center at INCOIS in Hyderabad. This can be compared to the best in the world and probably much better than many other centers, well-established centers elsewhere in the world. Within 8 minutes, we get a bulletin from the time the earthquake occurs. And except in Andaman and Nicobar, where the tsunami travel time is very critical, just 20 to 30 minutes, the entire east coast of India or the rest of Indian coastline will have sufficient time to warn our people. Somebody asked me, I said, why was this not done earlier? Why was it done only after the tsunami? I told them, the reason is very simple. We didn't realize that we'd require this kind of a system in our place. In fact, I read a UN report which talked about 85% of the journalists world over not realizing and not knowing what a tsunami actually was when the Indian Ocean tsunami occurred in 2004. So when we felt the need, our Indian scientists rose to the challenge and in a record time set up this Tsunami Early Warning Center. Our people on the East Coast or on the West Coast, should there be an earthquake in the Makran range, will be safe should there be a tsunami. Now coming to the Himalayan states, this is going to be a challenge. Of course, in a very limited area which cover the pilgrimage track to Amarnath Ji or Vaishnav Devi, the IMD has been able to come out with warnings every morning, early morning, and this has helped, and this is communicated to the stakeholders, and this would help the authorities to regulate the movement of pilgrims on that particular day. We have to look at nearly 40,000 square kilometers, a treacherous terrain, highly inclement weather, high altitude. And what kind of observational facilities do we need to develop? Well, let us all hope that a disaster like what we have witnessed in June doesn't occur again. But then this is the worst case scenario that we have witnessed. And I think when we talk of lessons to be learnt, we need to look at what needs to be in place, and particularly in a state like Uttarakhand, where the inflow of tourists and pilgrims is almost twice as that of the local people there, and the tourist season is limited. So a large number of people come during a short period of time, which also coincides with the rainy season to some extent. And for extreme weather events like what we have witnessed in June this year, it was a very unexpected time of the year to expect this kind of a rain or even a simple normal rainfall, because too early in the monsoons. So these are the challenges that we have. Now what we have to really look forward to is not just incremental increases. I know, I am aware, we are all aware that whether it is the IMD or the CWC, they have proposed certain expansion during the 12th plan period. But what more do we need to do? We may not get all the answers today, but I think we need to seriously think on those lines. We look forward to the presentations by Dr. Nayak, Mr. Bipash Kumar, the chairman of the CWC, and also Dr. Dadwal from the NRSC. Before I hand over to Dr. Sailesh Nayak, I would like to recall the confusion that was created by something which was put up by a television channel a few days after the Uttarakhand disaster unfolded, of what was supposed to be a warning issued by ISRO at 1 p.m. on the 16th, and they started telecasting an image from a slide that was created on the 18th from an experimental study being carried out by ISRO, and they went on and on. If we had to go by the anchor of that show, criminal cases should have been booked against the Honorable Prime Minister, against the Honorable Home Minister, against myself, and the Honorable Chief Minister of Uttarakhand for negligence leading to murder of 1,000 people. I mean, this is a limit to which sensationalism has been carried by the media. But then, we had the imagery, though it was not ISRO, all inputs are provided to the IMD, which comes out with their forecast. And certainly, the kind of forecast that IMD has made of very heavy rainfall needs to be improved, to be more precise, to bring in an element of forecasting. Technology must be put in place. And I think we can achieve tangible results in trying to bring all that is available and ensure better coordination between our hydrometeorological agencies, the space agency, and make sure that we can evolve a plan to create such a capability within a reasonable time frame. I would now request Dr. Sailesh Naik to take over, and with his presentation and his remarks. You can introduce.
A few words about Dr. Sailesh Naik. He is presently serving as Secretary to Ministry of Earth Science as the President, Indian Society of Remote Sensing, Dehradun. He is also the President of International Society of Photogrammetric and Remote Sensing, Technical Commission 4 on Geo Databases and Digital Mapping for the term 2004-2008, and has represented ISRO at the International Ocean Colour Coordinating Group and International Global Observation Strategy Coastal Theme. During his tenure as director, the Indian National Centre for Ocean Information Services, Hyderabad, has been transformed into a knowledge and information technology enterprise for the oceanic realm and has become provider for operational ocean information and advisory services. He has set up state-of-the-art early warning system for tsunami and storm surges in the Indian Ocean. He was responsible for the conceptualization and development of marine GIS. He made outstanding contributions in improving advisory services related to potential fishing zones, ocean state forecast, and Indian Agro Project. Dr. Sailesh Naik.
First of all, I am extremely grateful to Honorable Sridhar Reddyji for inviting me and sharing my thoughts on the extreme weather. Today morning when I opened the newspaper, I saw that the Kedarnath and Badrinath Yatra has been started. And the first line below that is check the weather. I mean, advisories to the Yatris. And I think this one line has put tremendous responsibility on us, that when it appears that for all this, the weather is something which is extremely critical. And I think at the same time, it's quite complex process. It's not a straight science, which is like physics or chemistry. But at the same time, we need to understand the complex nature of the weather and climate and how we have been able to address this issue. So I'm extremely grateful to give me this opportunity to explain that what we have been doing and what is planned in the future to further improve upon these services. Next. Yeah, okay, I'll do it. No problem. Switch on this. Okay, I'll do that. No problem.
Bad job.
See, the most important aspect is, in this case, is the very timely and the accurate forecast which is needed for a variety of the extreme weathers. Some of them are we have been able to do, like the heavy rainfalls or a cyclones or a storm surge. Some of them we are unable to do today, like thunderstorm or hailstorms. The important aspect is what we need is a continuous improvement in the observations, which Honorable Vice Chairman has mentioned. The development of various techniques to assimilate these observations into the models and to understand the process and ultimately to build the capacity to forecast. Next. This is a very simple diagram which gives you the idea that how the modeling and the forecasting is done. You see the variety of the data which is taken, and this is data is a global data is being used. It is about 20 GB per day, and the right lot of processing in the model, global models and the regional mesoscale models have been used, and then the forecast is given. I will come into greater detail later on. But the most important aspect is to do this you need a very high computing system, which we were not having. We built this capacity only in 2009, and still we are in the process of building this capability. Next. You can see that the kind of information which is goes now into the system, the initially there were very a small amount of data used to go. Now you can see that after 2008, we have substantially improved the kind of data goes. And the data is not about the atmosphere alone, but it includes the land surface, ocean, it also includes the satellite, aircraft, upper air. Large amount of data is now getting into the models. Next. And because of this, you can see that continuously we have been improving our forecast. This is the comparison with the four best today is the US and UK. And you can see that we are able to match more or less with US and UK kind of a forecast. What we are behind is only the European forecast, and that also in the fourth and fifth day. Up to 3 days, our forecast has more or less reached to a global level. And this is continuous improvement which has happened in last 5 years or so. So we have, I would say that the forecasting, the basic the win, we have achieved more or less at the global standard. Next. Once you have this, there are different kinds of models which we use, and this was one of the confusion during the Uttarakhand. The first is the 25 kilometer, the global models, which we have been using and which so I showed you, which showing very good skill almost up to the 5 days. The second, we have the large number of ensembles, about 20 ensemble members, and this also we are using for the providing guidance to the forecaster. The third is the regional forecast, which is WRF models are run at a different levels, 27, 9 and the 3 kilometers, and this for the 3 days in advance. Now all these products are available to the local forecaster, in this case the Dehradun, and based on the output of the models as well as the synoptic condition in that region, which includes the rainfall surface pressure and the temperature, etc., as well as the satellite data, especially the INSAT, the radar data, the radar, you may say the radar is not the Uttarakhand, but the Patiala and Delhi radar does cover part of the Uttarakhand. So all that is being used and the forecast is been given. And then the routinely the accuracy is been checking. So this is the overall system by which we have been working. At the first level, this is national forecast, and then regional forecast, and then the local forecast. Next. And the next important thing is the nowcasting. This nowcasting has been now introduced into the areas where we have a Doppler weather radar, and the 117 towns are now under this. You can check, this is the 24 hours and 6 hourly forecast is being given for all these towns. Next. There are also customized service which was mentioned in the morning about the Amarnath, is also the Chadam, and the many others, we like Kumbh Mela, the customized service is being also provided where we know large amount of people are likely to be gathered. And this can be done for any specific area or a specific region where we need a very specialized and customized kind of a forecast. Next. The extreme rainfall, this is the images which for the Uttarakhand, you can see that we had a very clear view on the 5-day forecast, which clearly showed a large amount of or heavy to very heavy rainfall in the Uttarakhand region. And this is the basic forecast which was used. Next, I will also show you. Next is the WRF model, which also very clearly showed, and it is much more detailed than the what earlier. This is the 9-kilometer resolution model, and which also showed extremely heavy rain in many parts of the Uttarakhand, Himachal and the surrounding regions. The next, this also, there are also the reason some of these issues came, and about the climate change. It is now believed that there is a very clear link between what happens in the Arctic melting and the, especially in the northwest India, the Pakistan floods or this Uttarakhand has a very close link when the melting is extremely rapid. Next. This is also Gujarat floods, heavy rainfall, which is very happened, which was given the forecast 5 days in advance, and this is a cumulative rainfall, which is essentially a low pressure area created, and about almost for a week there was extremely heavy rainfall in the Gujarat. Next. The second, which is very important, is the cyclone, and this is how the cyclone, we have now 4-day forecast, track forecast has been introduced, and the skill has improved considerably in the last 5 years. And you can see that we have now the skill of a landfall about 90 kilometers, which used to be earlier about 150 or so. Similarly, for the track is about 135. And the surface wind, which we have now been able to do, is about 10 knots. See, normally during cyclone, the winds would be about 90 plus knots. So plus minus 10 knots is extremely good system. Next. This is the track forecast error, which has been improved. You can see from 175 to almost 90 or so. And this is one reason that now you have to look at the much smaller region where the evacuation has to be done. And we have now, earlier we were giving only a 48-hour, but now there are 96-hour forecast is also given. So we are trying to increase the both the temporal and the spatial improvement in this. Next. This is the landfall point improvement which has occurred, and the top one and the below one is the surface wind. So you can see that with increasing observation and the better models, we are in the process toward improving our accuracies of the forecast. Next. The reason for this is, one is the scatterometer winds. Our OSCAT is our own satellite, which is on the OceanSat 2. And this we have now been able to assimilate for the cyclone, and which has considerably improved both the track and the estimation of the wind. Next. The second is the megatropic Saphir. It is a radiometer which is now being used for the, it gives a water vapor at the 6 different levels, and this data is now assimilated also for the cyclone, which also allows us to understand the intensity of the cyclone much better and the rainfall which is likely to occur. Next. The storm surge, which is also actually the main damage, is done by the wind and the storm surge. And this is now we have been able to give a storm surge. This was 1.2 or so during the Maasen in May, and actual observation was around 1.4 or so. So we are pretty close to giving the the storm surge forecast as well. Next. Now, there is always a question whether the climate change is doing anything, because each and every time this extreme, though individual events cannot be linked to a climate change, but we have seen that the intensity or the frequency of many extreme weather events have considerably increased in last 50 to 70 years. And this is where the variability increases furthermore, and it becomes further more difficult to give a forecast. Next, I'll show you some of the examples. This is the heavy rainfall events, more than 15 centimeter. And you can see that it is increased in three main areas. It is on the west coast and the central India and northeast, and of course in the northwest India. These are the areas where the heavy rainfall events larger than 15 centimeter has increased considerably. Next. Similarly, the heat waves is also increased considerably, and plus the number of hot days also increase considerably. Next. So to address some of these issues, we are also generating now the products which gives you the monthly areas where the warm and cold nights are available. This would be useful on the long term to plan if there are likely to be any disease or any action is to be taken. Next. This is for the rainfall product, which is essentially useful for the monitoring of the drought. So this kind of a new products are now being generated, which would be quite useful for many of the responding to such kind of an event. Next. Now the issue is what we are doing. Vice Chairman already mentioned some of those things. We have a plan on the Himalayan meteorology where the most important thing is the observation, but that is not enough. We need to build a customized models which would allow us to do the very accurate forecasting of the severe weather events and on a smaller areas. What this is one of the issues which were said, that if you stay in this region, it's not enough. You need to have a region more specific. That means we need to run models not at 3 kilometer or a 9 kilometer, but it's a 1 kilometer. Now, when you want to run a model at a 1 kilometer, you need very high power of computing. So, which is we are in the process of the building. But at the same time, just buying computer is also not going to solve the problem, because you need a kind of a people who can run and develop those kind of a models. So, there is a lot of things which is need to be done, and we have already planned. I'll come into the end. Then there are a special forecast required for a specific track. We are already giving specific forecasts, say those people who are going to say Mount Everest or for any mountaineering. We can build a specific forecast for a specific route, that this is the route, from a Rishikesh to Rudraprayag, that can be also built into the system. So this kind of a specialized kind of a thing which we need to do, and of course Vice Chairman mentioned about the nowcasting, which we are already going to be implement very shortly in areas where there is a large amount of people are there. So this is the one plan, and you can see that we have planned some of the Doppler weather radars and some of the systems in entire the Himalayan park. Next. The second, which is very important thing which has happened, is the launch of InSat 3D. This is something which is extremely important, and I can realize that it will provide us temperature and humidity profiles. Today, all over India, we have about 40 to 50 such profiles which goes into the models. And this satellite will provide millions of profiles. And not that we will be getting only twice a day, this will provide every half an hour. So this is going to make a major change and improvement into the our forecasting. And this data has already started, it is under testing, I'm sure Dadwal would be able to tell us more on this, but I think another couple of months we would be able to use this data operationally. Next. The third is there are a large number of understanding of the various processes is required. One is the clouds. How the clouds are forming, how they interact with the aerosol, which clouds are going to rain, how much they are going to rain. There are a lot of questions. And today none of the models have been able to simulate clouds into the models. So we need to understand many things. We have now set up a permanent lab in Mahabaleshwar to understand various interaction which cloud has with the aerosols. And we are trying to build a scheme by which can be used into the numerical weather prediction models. So this is the one. Next. So basically what we need to do is we are now trying to improve upon. One is the probabilistic advisories which will give even 5 to 7 days in advance. Then we will have the high resolution models which will give in 3 days advance, and the now casting which is also needs a very high resolution models because you have to assimilate the radar data into these models which will give up to 6 hours in advance. So these are the new forecasting prediction strategy which we have been working. It will take some time before we put this into a practice. And the lastly, next, what we need, the four things. One is of course the observation systems. And we have now already planned for the Himalayan meteorology. We have now InSat 3D. We are trying to acquire an aircraft to make the upper air observations. And the general augmentation of all kinds of observation, automatic weather station, automatic rain gauges, upper, and many others. So this is one major program. The second is we need to understand the weather system processes. One, I gave you the example of a cloud physics, but that's not the only, the changing water cycle, because the precipitation patterns are changing. So we need to understand what exactly it will have impact on the forecasting. Ocean air interactions, especially Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea, and ice sea and air interaction. So these are the processes which we need to study. The next is the improve your models and assimilation techniques, for which we have two major programs, monsoon mission and extreme weather modeling. And then to facilitate the model, we need to augment our high performance computing systems. And the most important is we need people which has to be sustained basis. And we have set up the advanced training school in our system science. This is where we build people, about 30 every year, who can do the weather and climate modeling. So this is what we need entirety to improve upon the forecast. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
We'll go on to the next presentation, please.
Our next speaker is Dr. Vinay Kumar Dadwal. He is currently Director, National Remote Sensing Center, Hyderabad, and has in the past served many important positions in the government as well as in the United Nations. He is Fellow of National Academy of Agricultural Sciences, New Delhi, and corresponding member of International Academy of Astronautics. He is also the President, Indian Society of Remote Sensing for the period 2012-2014, President, Indian National Cartographic Association for 2012-2013, and Editor, Journal of Indian Society of Remote Sensing. He is also at present President of the 8th Technical Commission of International Society for Photogrammetry and Remote Sensing for the period of 2012 and 2016. Dr. Vinay Kumar Dadwal.
Good afternoon, Honorable Vice Chairman, Dr. Shalesh, Shri Vivas Kumar, Chairman CWC, all the distinguished audience. It's a privilege for me to be able to make a brief presentation on extreme weather events. Basically, I would be covering more activities of NRSC, but I would like to specifically thank Dr. Shailesh Nayak. He highlighted three important activities. One is that for making weather forecast, you need observations, and nobody makes better observations than a satellite. Two, he clearly said that data alone is not sufficient. It's the assimilation and the understood model what is required. And of course, third is the recent exciting things which have happened, including the availability of data from megatropics, Cirrus Altica, and InSat3D. So these points I will just touch in passing, but I would try to also say that there is an aspect of extreme weather more than forecasting. Even if you have forecasted and extreme weather does happen, it does create a lot of issues. A lot of those issues can also be seen by satellite and which have to be understood and put in that context. Just as a beginning, what I would like to say is there are elements of extreme weather, but actually the damage doesn't happen from a single element. It's a combination of events, as was pointed out. You know, when you have a cyclone, you have a heavy rain and strong wind which produces damage. And of course, what we have been discussing, suppose you have heavy rain in hills which creates landslide, you can have a glacier lake which is stopped, or any landslide creates a lake which then bursts, which creates a flash flood. So it is a combination of extreme events which are more damaging. And the EM database at Belgium indicates that these extreme events have increasing every decade, and the climate change IPCC also predicts the number of extreme events are only going to change. Next. So the ISRO focus is on specifically these five points. One, ISRO provides satellites and platforms which can help in either monitoring extreme event, or they provide inputs which help in prediction of the extreme event. Part two, we provide satellite data. NRSC does for most of the Earth observation satellite. I'll just touch that in passing. Third, we also monitor in near real time the impact of the extreme. So it's not the forecast, but it's like once it has happened, what exactly has happened. We also do R&D to improve the techniques. Especially, I will show some of the case studies which have come up from Space Application Center in Ahmedabad on use of this weather data. Plus, there are non-EO space technology applications, basically communication and navigation.